Every mobile phone, every laptop, every electric car battery is filled with precious metals that could soon be cheaper to recycle than to mine from the ground. That's the vision of Tesla co-founder JB Straubel, who was the mastermind behind its battery technology. Straubel left Tesla in 2019 to focus on making lithium-ion batteries fully recyclable. It was a pretty unusual move for someone who probably doesn't need to work anymore.
I had many, many people, you know, kind of looking at me inquisitively like, you're going to work on garbage?
He now believes that he has the technology needed to recycle these batteries at his startup company, Redwood Materials.
2 to 3 truckloads a day of old batteries and electronics arrive. So it can be anything from, you know, your old iPhone battery to a scooter to an electric bicycle to a power drill or a toothbrush.
So they're starting small. About half of the waste is consumer products, but the other half is leftover scrap from battery manufacturing companies. Redwood has raised more than $700 million to help build electric car batteries without the need for any new mining.
You know, there aren't that many electric vehicles reaching end of life yet. As we sit here today in 2021, you know, it's a relatively small amount. So, you know, we didn't want to wait to build the company. We didn't want to wait to innovate and understand the chemistry, and therefore we can get started and grow the business and still, you know, generate revenue and make profit working with other categories of materials. But the chemistry and how we do that process is almost identical. So everything we're learning and everything we're inventing right now is 100% applicable, you know, as we continue to scale up and see a higher and higher mix of electric vehicle batteries reaching end of life.
Beyond recycling, Redwood's mission is to build a massive facility focused on manufacturing sustainable cathode materials. It aims to produce enough material to support 1 million EVs by 2025 and 5 million by 2030. In the process, it hopes to simplify and cut down the global logistics needed for today's electric vehicles. But if electric cars are zero emission already, why is recycling their batteries so important? To answer this, we need to look at the journey that battery materials make before they end up inside the vehicle. Take cobalt, one of the metals used to make a battery's cathode. The biggest source of this metal is the Democratic Republic of Congo, where it is often extracted by hand in very low-tech and dangerous mines by young boys. It could then be shipped to Finland, home to Europe's largest cobalt refinery, before heading to China, where a majority of the world's cathode production takes place. From there, it might be shipped to, say, Nevada, to create battery cells that get clustered into packs, ahead of their final journey to a car production line in California. All told, the cobalt travels more than 20,000 miles from the mine to the automaker before a buyer emerges and places a zero-emission sticker on the bumper. The pathways for lithium, nickel, manganese, and other elements are different, but no less complex.
Is environment your biggest motivation? And when did you have this sort of eureka moment or the aha moment that this was a problem, was not being addressed, and you could play a role?
The environment is one of the key motivations for this, and you know there are many others. You know, economics, I would say, is up there near parity with the environment. Batteries need an appropriate disposal solution once they do reach end of life. You know, we can't just throw them in the landfill. You know, they have hazards. So when you make a battery and you sort of engineer and create all the materials that go into that, it does have some emissions, and those are, you know, the so-called embedded emissions in the product itself. And by recycling a higher and higher percentage of those materials that go into the battery, you know, we can reduce dramatically the embedded emissions. Essentially, you get to, you know, kind of go through and use those materials again and again. And the more times you reuse them, the less emissions they'll have, you know, from when they were first created.
So when the e-waste arrives, what's the process they go through to break it down?
We have a few different pathways that it goes through, depending on what the material is. If it's a piece of production scrap material, we'll go through a mechanical separation process first. Then we go into what we call hydrometallurgy, where we'll put those metals into a solution form, basically make them a liquid, and then use different aspects of their chemistry to separate one metal from another. And then once they're separated, we reconstitute them back into, you know, a product, a solid form. And those, you know, refined metals are what we then can sell back into the supply chain to offset the need for a mine material.
So fast forward, I don't know if I'm giving you enough time, 10 years, 15 years, you know, to what extent are we seeing the equivalent of a giant unmanufacturing facility where robots are taking apart smartphones and doing the thing that you're describing?
You know, we will see, maybe not as far as 10 or 15 years, hopefully before that, we will see, you know, large unmanufacturing facilities. You know, I feel like in the world today, we have so much focus on manufacturing and so much investment in manufacturing, and only a very tiny fraction of that, you know, mental thought and capital goes into unmanufacturing. part of that is what we're doing. You know, we're adding and inventing that unmanufacturing process and treating it with a very technological view, the same way that we would treat building and designing a new factory.
So if a circular economy is to become a reality, unmanufacturing, the reversal and reuse of products, could become as normal a concept as manufacturing industries are today. Only 2,500 roadsters were ever sold. It's a long way from that to the giant gigafactory that JB helped design and build, which is now pumping out lithium-ion batteries at an ever-increasing rate. If we want a zero-carbon future, what we choose to do with those batteries at their end of life could be as important as the switch away from petrol-fueled cars.